This conference will now be recorded.
Yes, fine.
Yeah, thank you.
Yes, fine, good.
Yeah, thank you. Guys, do you have any questions regarding previous session? Anybody have any questions? Vipin, that issue get resolved?
Good morning, Venkat. So not yet. So I will share you the screenshot on email.
Okay. Or else, I mean, end of the session we'll continue that one if we have time. Okay.
Okay, fine. Thank you.
Yeah. Anybody have any other questions, guys? Anybody have any open questions? I hope you people got the recording. Yesterday I did that one. So yesterday we discussed about the error handling part, and then still we'll continue that error handling only. Okay, a few more things we'll discuss today on error handling part. So here I'm trying to introduce the JMS concept also. I will explain that one. So while subscribe and sending the data into JMS queue, okay, so that time we'll continue that missing error handling part, like on error propagate and then rolling rollback exception strategy we'll discuss. And then somebody asked yesterday how to create a manual exception, right? So how to create using throw, that one also we'll discuss, guys. So before that, there is a queuing mechanism called ActiveMQ. There are two open source in the market related to queuing mechanism. One is ActiveMQ, another one is RabbitMQ. And then apart from that, we have a Anypoint MQ, that's a MuleSoft. There is a MuleSoft product, and again there is a Amazon SQS. So people are using Amazon SQS also. That is also a queuing mechanism. For each queuing mechanism, if you want to push the message or else pull the message, there is a separate connector in the MuleSoft. That is nothing but a client, you can say. Using that specific client, you can push the message or else you can pull the message. So pulling the message means you no need to separately pull the mechanism. There is no pulling mechanism. It's nothing but an inbound connector, right? You people are aware about the inbound connector. So means we have to keep it into the source location. When you are keeping into the source location, that particular connector, we subscribe that queuing mechanism, right? Means the queuing mechanism, the queue name, and then queuing mechanism configuration, we have to keep into the that inbound connector, whatever the client I'm talking about, client in the sense that specific queuing mechanism have a client in MuleSoft. Means for example, there is a ActiveMQ is the queuing mechanism. Okay, this is it's kind of a broker. Okay, so for consuming or else for subscribing or else for pushing the message or else you can say publish, right? Publish or push the message. Further, we have a client called JMS. So the JMS, we can search in the palette. We have a for consuming, for acknowledgement, for a listener, for publish. So we have many JMS specific components are here. And then similarly for RabbitMQ, we have a AMQP connector. For Amazon SQS, we have a Amazon SQS connector. For AnyPointMQ, we have a AnyPointMQ connector. Like that, for each mechanism, we have a specific client is here. And then subscribe is nothing but whatever the configuration here. So how to reach this mule, how to reach this queuing mechanism, what is the queue you are using, what is the topic you are using, what is the configuration for that, what is the user ID, password, that whole information we have to keep it into the inbound connector of our listener, right? nothing but listener here, that is nothing but here inbound connector, the JMS connector. Once you put that information in the configuration, that is nothing but a subscription, right? What it will do, so whenever the message is available in the particular queue, right, means, so you, I said here you have to do the configuration, right? Suppose, for example, here is the destination is in, I mentioned IN. So whenever the IN destination is nothing but here, it's nothing but a queue name, okay? So when the queue is available, the IN queue, it should be there in the queuing mechanism, so that accordingly we have to configure in the JMS connector, so that whenever the message is available in the queue, right, it automatically pulled out. You don't need to trigger the event, right? So that automatically corrected. It's keep on trying. Whenever the message is available, right, it pulled out automatically. So when these kind of scenarios will come into the picture, so people, there are several systems. There are several systems. They are trying to push the message into the queue, right? So here is, we're talking about only one queue. There are several queues are there, right? So the scenario is like this. So there are several systems. For example, we have several portals, suppose like persona, and then there is a hero. There are several systems. They're facing some issues. Think like this. They're facing some issues. Suppose unable to log in, or else once logged in, they're facing some role-based issues, right? So they want to raise a ticket basically, okay? So for resolving their issues, okay? So what they will do, they simply dump into the message into based on their sources, right? So they dump into the issues in the tickets. They're going to create a ticket in the queues. What MuleSoft will do, so whenever the ticket is available in the queue, right, they pulled out. So because we subscribed already, they pulled out the message, and then accordingly, whatever the business logic you'll write for resolving that issue, right? So we'll take that issue, we'll take that particular issue based on the message ID, based on the assignee, right? MuleSoft will take it to assign the particular person, right? Suppose persona is facing some issue. Persona is nothing but a portal guys. So persona guys are facing some issue, right? To logged in, or else once logged in, they're facing some issue, role-based specific issue. So what MuleSoft will take, once pulled out the message, it will assign to the particular person, right? Based on the assignee, the persona L3 team, support team is there. So they will assign to the persona L3 team so that they will take care and then they will resolve it actually. So like that, so what I'm trying to say here, so there are several vendors, there are several systems simply throwing the message into the queue. What our role is here as a middleware guy, so you have to pull out the message, okay, according to subscription, whatever the business logic they are saying, we have to continue that business logic, right? So then we have to resolve that issue, whatever the business logic, we have to continue it, okay? Hope you guys are clear. So where queuing mechanism come into the picture, so this is one scenario guys. There is other scenario, like suppose generally, if suppose there is an integration between MuleSoft and Salesforce, right? So you'll take one of the object in the Salesforce, like opportunity. So if you want to create a single opportunity, it's kind of a asynchronous in the sense, asynchronous, once you get the request, we'll push to the Salesforce. Immediately we'll get the response. That is nothing but a synchronous, okay? So what business want sometimes, suppose Salesforce have a agents guys, right? So they have some Excel sheets kind of thing. The each Excel sheet or each CSV sheet contains more than 2000 opportunities at a time. So these kind of means nothing but a multiple orders creation, multiple opportunities creation, multiple leads uploads, right? So for these kind of things, we can't go for synchronous way. means if you upload 1,000 opportunities or 2,000 opportunities at a time, so your server can't able to respond at a time, so 2,000 responses back. Hope you guys are clear. So these kind of scenarios will go for asynchronous. Okay, asynchronous in the sense, so we'll take a 2,000 opportunities at a time. Okay, we'll push into the some queuing mechanism. Okay, so from the queuing mechanism, we'll pull it out one by one. So then one by one, we'll push into the target system, either it's a Salesforce or I'll say either it's a whatever the target system it is. So that is another scenario. So there is one more scenario, like, so sometimes business people will ask, they want to execute that opportunities because it's a already business time is running. Suppose they don't want to run in a business time, that whatever the opportunities you are going to create it, so they don't want to run in a daytime or else business time, they don't want to run that bulk opportunities at a time, so they want to run in a non-business time. Okay, so that we should not stop our consumers, means whoever consuming the MuleSoft, we should not stop them. So boss, oh, you have to run in the only non-business hours. We should not tell like that. It's a end of the day, it's a business. If they're creating an opportunity, means we are going to create a business to our target system, so that we should not stop them. So what we can do is we can expect the whatever the opportunity they are going to create it. We can expect that what MuleSoft will take care, MuleSoft will push that into the queuing mechanism, one of the queuing mechanism, either it's a RabbitMQ, whatever the queuing mechanism, whenever the non-business hours time will come. So what we can do is we can pull out the message one by one message from the queuing mechanism, we can push into the target system. So these kind of scenarios will go for queuing mechanism process, guys. So anybody have any questions?
Do we need to install this HTTP or it configure?
It's a my question is, listen carefully, my question is, do you have any questions on these scenarios? I will explain that part, whole guy. Okay. If you don't have any questions, I will go next level. So coming to that part, see, this is a configurable, you no need to install this. Okay. So you can download this part from the Google. Okay. So there is a directly website is there. So that is nothing but apache.org, guys. You can download from that ActiveMQ from that website. It's a free only. Okay, here you can see multiple versions are there. You can take from the latest. There's a window. One second, guys. Okay, sorry for that. So here is the location, guys. You can simply download this part. Okay, what you can do is, once you download, there is no installable. It's just unzip that part. It's a zipped content, right? Just unzip it and keep it into some location. Either generally we'll keep into the program files. Either you can keep into the program files. Sometimes, you know, if you are using office laptop or some your personal laptop also, sometimes access denied will get. It's better to have keep it any other location. Hope you guys are clear what I'm trying to say. So sometimes, you know, your administrator will keep some permissions. Admin only have to open the program files, some kind of thing. So that time, you know, when you're trying to run your this ActiveMQ, it will give some issue. Okay, so that what you can do is you can keep into any other folder if you have. So then it will come like this once unzip it. Apache ActiveMQ 5.1 point, and this is I am using this the latest version. Open this, and then here is the bin folder is there. Under bin you can see Windows 64 and Windows 32. Okay, so most of the people nowadays Windows 64 only. Open this Windows 64 and then open the command prompt. Okay, I already did, I guess. So open the command prompt till there, and then I'll just open like this. Okay, you'll get like this. After that, ActiveMQ start, that is a way to start it. This is a way to start it, guys. Once you've done that, so it will get like this. You won't get any issues mostly if you have rights and all. So you can see this ActiveMQ start. Okay, this is the start command. If you are using less than versions, guys, suppose I'm using 5.15, right? Suppose if you download less than 5.0 or else less than 5.10, there is a batch file also there. You can start the batch file also. ActiveMQ batch file is there. We can start the batch file that way also. You can start it. So once you start it successfully, you can see in the bottom the URL will, you can see it, http://008161. Okay, if you ActiveMQ not start properly, you can't able to see that one. So then, so that you can't able to see the browser also, whatever I shown you, right? So the this option also you can can't able to see. So that, so take this URL http://008161. So this is a browser URL. So put it to here and then click enter. So that first time it will ask the username and password. Admin is the username and password. Okay, so I already given the username and password. I logged in as admin. Okay, so that you can see all the tabs here. So first time it will give the empty thing. I created queues and all, so topics also should empty here. Okay, so maybe in your case all are empty. Okay, so that whatever the queue name you want to create it, and just go queue name here and create it. Okay, similarly topics also, if you are pushing the message, you no need to create a topic. So your MuleSoft will take care to create the topic also, automatically get created topic name. Okay, so this is the ActiveMQ, guys. Just explore on these areas. So what is one by queue, what is one by topic, right? So how many subscribers are there, so how many maximum subscribers you can give it, right? So just explore on this area. But according to our MuleSoft, so these two required: how to create a queue, how to create a topic. Once create the queue, so how to send it, how to delete it. So what is meant by number of consumers? So what is meant by message NQ, DQ, number of pending messages? So these things required. Okay, so that too in a real time. So now it's better to have a little bit knowledge on the ActiveMQ, RabbitMQ, these are queuing mechanisms. So specific to queuing mechanism, there are separate administrators will be there. So they will take care to create the queues and topics. So what they will do, they will share the information, right? As a middleware guy, so we'll get the information from these administrators and then put into your connector. Okay, so that is a way, guys, to start the ActiveMQ. So anybody have any questions in this?
What are the details we'll get from the admin for connecting to this?
For connecting, you can see the what are all the details required for your connector. That information we'll get. I'll just show you the configuration of your connector. The first of all, this is the destination queue name is required. Apart from that, I'm just maximize this. Okay, here is the username and password, admin. That generally they won't share the admin credentials. They will create a some other user for you. They will share that user like Mule user kind of thing. They will create it, and then they will use they will share the username and password. That is another thing. And then you can see there is a broker URL, guys. Observe here. If you see browser URL is different, right? Localhost 8161. Slash admin something q.jsp, right? 8161 is the port number for seeing the browser, right? But if you see the broker URL, there is a port number called 61616, right? So here we are using a local host, but so they will share the remote. Similarly, they will give the different username and password. And then next one is maximum redelivery. So this is it's they won't provide, so we have to keep it. Actually, how many times you can redeliver, you have to keep it. Suppose if sometimes failure happened, so how many times you have to, it's a business scenario, how many times maximum redeliver times, how many times you keep it. Only these things, guys. One is username and password, another one is broker URL, and then so there is a one more destination called QNAME. Okay, these are the information you have to get from them. So we have to create the configuration accordingly. Apart from that, we have to see, while discussing the DB concept, we added some third party jar file, right? So here also we need to add some third party jar file called ActiveMQ all. That is a jar file required that should be in our class path, guys. So go to properties and then libraries. You can see Java build path. I just added into the libraries ActiveMQ all, ActiveMQ all 5.15.7 jar file I added. So why? Because here, so internally we are using this connector. I mean, some built-in class is required for this connector, right? For establishing the connection. So we've seen already in the DB connectors, right? So somebody should take it to establish the connection between MuleSoft and the database, right? It will act like a bridge between MuleSoft and database. So here also such kind of bridge is required, such kind of driver is required, so that, you know, so we have to keep the jar file into the our class path. So that is a jar file called ActiveMQ all. So when you are trying to download that this thing, you can see the jar file here itself, right? Apache, here is the thing, right? Once you download that Apache ActiveMQ now, so that time only you can see the jar file, ActiveMQ all jar file. So keep it into the class path of a program. Okay, so any other questions?
In real time also we require this jar to handshake with the AQ.
It's required, but you should not keep like this. It should be in the form file. You have to add the dependency as a form file. You're clear, right? In the form file, you will get a dependency. Just add the form file. You no need to add like this, because the problem, you know, when you add like this, so we should not add like this, whatever the jar file I put into the class path. You know, if it is a one jar file, you can keep it like this. Tomorrow, 10 jar files required. You should not keep like this. The size of the zip, right? So the size of the jar in the 4.0, we can call it as a jar, right? Deployable archivable file. So the jar size becomes huge, right? So it should be form file on fly whenever you're trying to deploy it, whenever you're trying to compile it, whenever you're trying to build it. So that time it will take the dependencies, right? It's required.
Generally, we give the server common location, right, in the POM to access this.
No, it will download automatically. So see, that's what Maven come into the picture, right? We discussed, I guess, initial days itself. See, when we are trying to configure a Maven, C drive users, you can see the .m2 file, right? This is a repository. These are all jar files, guys. These are all jar files. Whenever required, it will download and keep into this location. Okay. So similarly, when you are trying to say, so generally what it will happen, you commit your changes, right? Once you're done with your code, some code repositories are there, right? Like Maven, like Git, and then Bitbucket, and then SVN, CSV. These are all code repositories. What you can do is you just commit your changes into that particular repositories. So on beyond that, so the DevOps team come into the picture. Generally, I'm trying to explain the process, what it will happen after commit your changes. You can commit or you can check in your changes into Git. So the DevOps team come into the picture. What they can do is, so they will implement a Jenkins process. So maybe you people are aware, right? The Jenkins jobs they will create it. What Jenkins jobs will do, they will build it again. So generally, what you can do is we'll test only in our local, right? We'll test in our only local. We are trying to build it. We are preparing that what we call jar file. Then we are trying to deploy it. That is one way. So there is a process called CI and CD process. Continuation integration and continuation development deployment, right? So once you have committed your changes, it will go to the Git. So the Jenkins job will trigger automatically whenever the latest commit is there. The Jenkins job, again, top of that, it will build it. Okay. When you are trying to build it, so that is in the separate server, right? So again, this Maven should install in that server. Okay, so like this, it will happen actually. Whatever the jars are there, it will take from that local machine for build. Okay, it should not keep into the, we should not show the particular path. Boss, take the jar file from this location. We should not keep it on fly. It will download that M2 repository location. So for compilation, for build purpose, it will take the jar file from this location. It will keep into the class path of that. Then it will execute it. Maybe in your case, what you are saying, there is a, I seen some of the web application development. I seen few of the jars will keep into some location. Few of the static files keep it into some location. On fly, they want to read it actually, because for avoiding performance issues and all. I'm not sure, but this is the process actually.
Okay. Yes.
So generally, you know, we have a two types of servers, right? Coming to Java process, I'm talking about web server and application servers, right? When you come into the web servers, what they can do is for avoiding the performance issues, they will keep all the static files, images, whole things are kept into the particular location. They're trying to read it on fly. So only that server they will keep it, they'll read it. Generally, you know, when you are reading some content from the Google itself, will read it. For example, some metadata files, right? If you see on the top of your XML file also, some metadata are there, right? So tomorrow they will remove that particular XSD information from the Google, from the website itself. Application build process get failed because that content have to read from the metadata. You're getting right. Suppose you are saying this one, if you see top of that, some metadata will be there. This is nothing but what some website address, you can see clearly, right? Some website address. So tomorrow they are going to remove it. It should not work, right? Your connector get failed to build it, right? So that what you can do is, so we'll download all these things. We'll keep it into some location, right? In our premises, we'll download all the things. We can read from the on-premises itself so that, you know, we can avoid the performance issues, and we can avoid whenever they are removing also, we won't get any issues. But only things is updates won't happen. So these kind of things they will keep it a separate server. They'll put all the information, they will read on fly, right? So that's all, I guess. Any other questions?
While practicing in our local system, how can you come to know the port number in the URL, like 5.1 and
That is the documentation, guys. You have to just go through the documentation. They clearly given the documentation, activemq.apache.org. You will get to know somewhere else, browser URL and the broker URL. Okay,
thank you.
Okay, so I'm sharing you. You don't need to search for the Google also. If you want to explore more on that ActiveMQ, you can explore it. There is a directly website is there. You will get to know. I seen somewhere else. I'm not remembering where it is. So I just get it there and put it into the location. So that is the ActiveMQ. So before this program, before this Mule app, you have to finish that part, the backend part. It's nothing but a backend part. Right? You have to create the queue, hold this stuff. You have to prepare it. After that, coming to our Mule flow. So this is a listener. It's nothing but inbound connector. So JMS is like a HTTP, right? HTTP will access a both inbound connector as well as outbound connector. Here is JMS is also both way. You can see the symbols also direction. Both the directions are there, right? Inbound connector as well as outbound connector. So once you keep that into the inbound connector, so fill that all configuration. I'm just highlighting once again the configuration part. You can see this is a mandatory I'm just giving. So that the destination we have to give it, that is nothing but a queue. And then here there is a number of consumers 4. So means number of consumers 4 means, if you see here, here is number of consumers 0. Here what it will do, number of consumers 4 means, suppose just now we spoke about one of the scenario, there are multiple vendors, multiple systems, they're simply dump into the message into ActiveMQ. So think like this, per minute 1,000 messages are coming to the ActiveMQ, right? So if you are keeping only one consumer, it will take more time to read it, right? More time to read it, 1,000 messages, so that we can increase maximum 4. We can increase it, guys, for node I'm talking about. So this is one server, right? One server in the sense when I'm trying to deploy this, so it will deploy into the Jetty server. That is only one server. But end of the day, when you are trying to deploy into the production, so there are more workers we can add it. Workers in the sense nodes, separate servers. So this application is going to deploy into multiple servers. It's kind of a, you know, load balancing thing. People are aware of it, right? So means this app, this application will go and deploy into multiple nodes, so that, you know, so each node is consumer is 4 consumers are there, so that, you know, so that becomes a 8, right? 8 consumers trying to pull the message, pull the 1,000 SMS, 1,000 messages. So that, you know, so it will quickly empty the queue, right? So that is nothing but a consumers. How many consumers you want to keep it, you can keep it. The maximum people can give 4 only, guys. Otherwise, you know, your Mule flow have a capacity, or else your configuration, like your RAM size, that will depend, right? So if you're keeping 10 messages at a time, your flow should have a capability, or else you are deploying into your cloud. So there is a vCore size. We have to increase the vCore size, right? Either you have to reduce the consumers, or else either we have to increase the vCore size, so that your app have a capability, your flow have a capability to consume at a time 4 messages, or else 10 messages. Right, that depends upon your complexity of your application. That's who, based on the vCore size, we'll discuss while deploying what is meant by vCore, what is meant by workers and all. So that's based on your RAM size. Okay, vCore is nothing but we'll assign some RAM, 1 GB, 2 GB RAM for your application. Based on that, your application get a capability to load at a time 4 messages or 10 messages like that. Okay, that is nothing but a number of consumers. And then apart from that, so this is a configuration I already shown you, JMS configuration. I just already added. Observe here. Here you can see three jar files added, right? The three jar files, once you done that ActiveMQ all jar files, right, that contains multiple jar files, ActiveMQ all. So the group of dependencies required for this ActiveMQ, guys, there's like client, broker, another one is ActiveMQ, Kada DB something. These are all jar files there under ActiveMQ all. Okay, so that you no need to add a separate jar file for this, right? Whenever you added all that ActiveMQ all, it will fill automatically required libraries. Apart from that, this a username and password, and then this is a broker URL, and then maximum delivery. It depends based on your business logic, how many times you want to redeliver it. You can keep the numeric accordingly. Okay, so that is about inbound connector configuration. According to this business logic, what I'm trying to achieve here, I'm trying to introduce on error propagate, as well as I'm trying to throw the manually exception. Once receive the message from the ActiveMQ, right, I'm just log it first time. Here I'm trying to display the attributes dot properties dot jmx properties dot jmx delivery count. You only added that, right? That how many times redelivery, that that count I'm trying to read it actually. Is this first time, is the second time, is this third time, like that I'm trying to read it. Only that information I'm just log into here, delivery count, first time, second time, third time, like that. After that I put a choice router here. So what choice router will do, again here, same thing, if equal to equal to 5, so means it's a fifth time, right? If it is a fifth time, then go here, else go in the bottom. So that way I put a condition. What choice router will do, it just route it based on the condition. If the according to my condition, 5 times it will read it, right? So first time, second time, third time, and till fifth time, equal to fifth time, it will go here, guys. It will go to top of the choice. And then apart from that, first time, second time, till fourth time, it will go here. Okay, if it is go fifth time, equal to equal to fifth time, so then I just logged it, transaction without error. Okay, I just hard coded. Once that is done, it will go to the send to JMS topic. Okay, I'm just push that message into the topic again. So here is the destination is topic one. You no need to create a topic one, so it will on fly, it will get create a topic. Okay, so here is the topic one. We are trying to throw the success message, push the message, success message into the topic one. Similar configuration it will applicable for, right, for connecting. You can see the same configuration name, JMS underscore config. You can see the same configuration again here, right? Broker URL, all these things. So one time creation configuration, we can use multiple times wherever you are using the JMS configuration. So that's all. If it is a failure case, what I'm trying to do in the failure case, it's a default condition. It's a execute connector, guys. One, you can see in the execute script, that is a component in the palette. You can see the scripting execute. I just drag and drop the scripting execute component, or else you can call it as a message processor. I'll just open this. What I'm trying to achieve in this, throw new exception. I'm just using the keyword called throw, whatever we discussed yesterday. Throw new exception if it is a failure case. What is the exception name? So this is the reason why the processing has failed. I just put a some statement. So yesterday we discussed if the age is less than 18, you are not eligible for voting. So within double quotes, if you keep it, so this kind of message, there is no built-in exception. So like built-in exception in the sense, there is a null pointer exception, there is a array index out of bound exception, there is an arithmetic exception. For every exception, there is a reason, right? When null pointer NPE will come, there is no information, but you are trying to operate on that. Suppose string, you assign some string empty value, you are trying to find out the length of the string, that time you will get a null pointer exception. Coming to arithmetic exception, anything by zero. So mathematically anything by zero, it will give a infinity, right? So that will give arithmetic exception. So there is no compilation issue, there is no runtime issue also, if in case of arithmetic exception your results will vary, right? So that is the arithmetic exception. So if you see, for each and every built-in exception there is a certain reason, right? But whereas in here, these kind of things, if a custom exception, there is no such kind of built-in exception. So we are trying to throw intentionally, we are trying to create a custom exception. The exception statement is nothing but this is the reason why the processing has failed. That's all. So here we choose a engine called Groovy Guides. So using this Groovy, it will support the Java things also. It will support when you're going for Groovy script, so it will support Java things, Java snippets. It will support like string split it. So suppose I want to split a some string, I want to I want to subtract the dates, I want to format the date. Suppose you are getting some different time zone format, I want to format properly the time, expected time, target system expected time. So these kind of snippets we can achieve in the Groovy script also, guys. Groovy script will support Java also. Okay, so that here what I'm trying to do, it I'm trying to throw this exception intentionally using Groovy script. Any questions? Okay, so hope you guys are clear. So whenever it get failed, so yesterday what we did in process level, so the error handling part you can do in a three levels, guys. Yesterday whatever we seen on error continue, that is a process level. Process level in the sense wherever the business logic you are writing, right? So that is nothing but a process level. It's a process flow, right? So process layer you can say. But whereas in here, it's a flow level I'm handling. There are three levels to handle error part. One is process level, second one is flow level, third one also there, guys. Third one also, I told you in the API kit will take a to route it. I was talking about yesterday, right? There is nothing but a global level. So suppose you are not handling here, anywhere you are not handling. In the process level, I'm not handling. In the flow level, I'm not handling. Suppose once you your flow will throw the error, where it will go? If you're not handling these two locations, it will go to the global level. Means your API kit, we not had discussed the RAML part. Once you've done the RAML part, your Mule application by default, your API kit will by default, it will give a few of the error handling, like what we discussed, like 405, 404, 400, 415. By default, API kit will give. If you're not handling anywhere, like process or flow level, it will go to the global level, it will handle it. Okay, yesterday we discussed only process level. Now we am showing into the flow level. Okay, so here what it will happen whenever the error will get through. So if choice router condition based, right? If the condition is satisfied, then it will go here. Apart from that, all the other cases, it will come to the default case. And then it anyway, it will intentionally, we are trying to throw the error, right? It will come to the error handling part. Okay, so in error handling part, according to yesterday thing, we just put a any, right? If you want to handle particular exception, keep it that particular thing, like connectivity issue, or else illegal body, or else some syntax issue. If you don't want to keep it like this, keep it any, right? It's if you are keeping it any, so any kind of exception, it will come here, right? So that inside what I'm trying to do it, I'm trying to put some message like for seeing in the logs clearly why it is rollback again, rollback transaction, the message rollback to its original state of the state for reprocessing. Okay, so anybody have any questions on this, guys? Hope you guys are clear. I clearly explained what I'm trying to achieve it. I'm trying to on propagate, I'm trying to show it. And then a rolling mechanism, that maximum redelivery, I put it. I'll try to show that part. And then parallelly, how to pull the message, how to push the message, means how to publish it, how to consume it. That thing also I'm trying to achieve it. Okay, I'm trying to deploy this application. Let's see. Okay, it's getting deployed. How this will trigger? You have to add a message, right? In the queue. I'm just adding the message. Here is the send is there option. Just click that. Before that, you have to create a queue, guys. And then here is the queue destination. Here is the add message. I'm just keeping. Welcome to ActiveInc. Okay, just put that. Welcome to ActiveMQ. Here is the option, guys. Click send button. So before that, I'm just clearing the all the logs. Delivery count 1. You can see clearly. Delivery count 2. Delivery count 3, 4, fifth time it should success, right? You can see this transaction without error. Hope you guys are clear. So first time the choice will check it. If the delivery count equal to 5, then it will route to success string, right? So it's a delivery count 1, so that it went to the where it went to the default condition. This is the message you can see there, right? This is the reason why the process is failed, right? So intentionally we are going to create some exception, right? Through we are trying to throw the exception using Groovy. You can see that this is the exception. And again, so according to our redelivery concept, we are keeping 5 times a redelivery, right? And again, second time it's trying to throw it, it's trying to pull the message, right? Second time. So this is the second time again, same thing happened. Third time, fourth time, fifth time. So the in case of fifth time, according to our choice router, the condition get true, so that you know, so it went to the this part. And then it will try to push the message into where into the topic, right? So that is happened in the last transaction without error. That is a log, right? Delivery 5. So let's see the topic. Earlier topic count is 3, I guess. Now the topic count is 4. Let me try once again. You can see the topic is 4, right? Let me try to hit once again. Means we have to add message. I'm just hitting as it is. Cancel, send it. Okay, same thing happened again. Let's see the topic count. It should be 5. Hope you guys are clear. So means what happened? We are trying to subscribe the message. And we are trying to process it according to our condition. It will 4 times it will get failed. Fifth time it will try to push the message into topic, that particular topic, right? So if you want to check it step by step, also you can see. Let me try to deploy in a debug mode. Guys, did you see any difference on error propagate, on error continue? So which one is where we'll use error propagate, where we'll use error continue? Did you see any difference? If you see difference wise, there is no if you see component, whatever I put it, there is no difference, guys. Only the difference, only the challenge is here. See error continue, if you want to see the success result, I just told yesterday also, if you want to see the, if you want to commit the results, if you want to see the success result, right, then that time you have to keep it on error continue. Whatever the target system is giving the result, if you want to continue same result, so then keep it on error continue. So if you want to see the error result, not success result, error result if you want to see, right? So you don't want to commit the transaction also. That time you have to go for on error propagate. That is the only difference. Apart from that, both are same. Just deployed it. I'll just keep a debug here. Q. Okay, you can see the body also, guys. Whatever you are sending there, right? Enter some text here from the message body. Same thing, right? From here it is coming. So here I'll just click next step. You can see the count here. The first time, right? The logger will says the count. Our delivery count one. We are trying to display that using that attributes. The mail expression. The second step is, it should see it went to the error case, right? Because you know the condition get failed, it should give an error, right? So then where it will go? It will go to the redelivery thing, right? It went to the an error propagate, right? It should go back again, right? The first time. So this is the second time again. You can see the redelivery count too. Similarly, second time, third time, fourth time, fifth time. So the condition is satisfied. It went to the success state, and then it should give to the send to JMS. It should not give error. Topics. It's not increasing, right? Maybe because of debug mode, I guess. Let me check in a normal mode. Getting some connection refused. What happened? I'll just restart it, guys. You can see this, the connection get reset. Maybe yesterday night itself I started. I'll just start it once again. Control C. Okay, see this, you can see the URL here. I'll just refresh this. Topics are zero. Required to restart, guys. See, in real time, your cloud hub, if the target system is not responding, your application automatically get restart, guys. You don't need to bother about that. There is an option called in Cloud Hub itself. If the there is a checkbox actually, if the response is not coming or else your target system is not responding, it's kind of some hang situation. So your application get restarted. See, the message is there earlier. What happened? Something messed up. This is the problem with ActiveMQ, guys. It's not our mail flow. Okay, you can see this now. So there is a problem with the ActiveMQ, guys. No worry about that. So it's not your flow. Okay, you can see the now topic. So that is about that. And then I'm trying to highlight a few more things. So here, the default form, you have to little bit changes required, guys. I'll just show you the what are the changes required for this specific to JMS. Here is the concept called shared libraries. By default, you can see this shared libraries. There's one of the plugin you need to add it. So just add this part. The shared library, you have to add this client. So that, you know, connection factory is one of the built-in class. The connection factory would get connection get established only if the shared library is available. Just try it without the shared library. If connection established, then well and good. Otherwise, you'll face the issue called connection factory, guys. I'll just show you the reference URL also if you want. I'll just capture it. It's a problem with Mule 4.x, guys. It's not 3.9 also, I didn't see any issue. You can see clearly the Mule 4.x known issue. This issue will get it actually. Handling messages, please verify that your config ActiveMQ client dependency shared library when you're deploying for application. You will face this issue, org.apache.activemq, ActiveMQ connection factory issue. Okay, so you can't able to deploy your application also if you get that issue. The resolution for that is, so you have to add the dependency first, ActiveMQ client in the POM Can you add that one dependency? After that, there's a shared library just now I shown in the pom.xml. We have to add the shared library. Okay, so you can add multiple shared libraries also. If by default, if you see yesterday, day before yesterday, we discussed about some database and all, right? That is required, this shared library, but you no need to add manually to get automatically added. But only in this case, this ActiveMQ client means ActiveMQ case only. So the we are getting this ActiveMQ connection factor issue, that is a known issue, so that you know. Extra shared library, you have to add it. So same thing I did. So I added one more extra shared library under shared libraries, so that it will get work. Otherwise, you know, the deployment get failed. Okay, so that's all for today. So anybody have any questions? I shared that. I'll share that link also, guys. Somebody want to see why that issue? That's a known issue. You can look into it. I'll just share the link. Guys, anybody have any questions? That's all for error handling. So that you know, still whenever we are introducing new concepts, there also will add the error handling part, so that you know we'll get more things. Okay, hope you are good. So nobody have a questions. And then Vipin, can you send your that screenshot so that I will look into it, the configuration screenshot. I will respond accordingly. Okay.
Yeah, sure. Thank you.
Thank you so much, guys. We'll meet tomorrow. Bye.